All right. Well, obviously, in the title of this meeting, there's a reference to Lenin's pamphlet, The State and Revolution, which is one of the classics of revolutionary Marxism, written by Lenin in the course of the Russian Revolution of 1917, and bringing together the essence of what Marx and Engels had wrote about the state, bringing that together with the revolutionary experience of 1917 itself. And if anyone here hasn't read State and Revolution, go and get it from Bookmarks, read it. It's a really important work. In it, Lenin shows how Marx and Engels understood the state as essentially a set of coercive institutions that operate in the interests of the exploiting class, so that the state is a form of class domination. And Lenin argues, drawing in particular on some of the things that Marx wrote about the state, that any workers' revolution can't use the existing state. This is a crucial difference with the reformist tradition, in which the aim precisely is to use the state to bring about changes in society. Any real revolution can't use the state, but has, as Marx himself put it, to smash it. That, in an essence, is the argument of the state and revolution. Now, the title of this meeting is The State and Revolution Today. Don't worry, I don't have any pretensions to be trying to update Lenin and come up with a new version of the state and revolution. Nothing like that. But I think that it's an important question to address, because much of the contemporary left ignores the issue of the state. The state, if we go back to the 1960s and 1970s, there were immense discussions on the left, big theoretical debates about the nature of the state, its relationship to the capitalist class, how that was to be understood, all sorts of different theoretical approaches. There was something among German Marxists that then kind of spread to some British Marxists called the state derivation debate, which was essentially about the relationship between the state and capitalist society as a whole. It was an intense theoretical preoccupation, and this theoretical preoccupation reflected a practical understanding that having the proper approach to the state was critical to any strategy for overthrowing capitalism. Now, to a very large extent, that preoccupation has disappeared. There's very little discussion of the state. There's some quite theoretical discussions about the state as part of an international system of states, and the relationship between that system and capital, and so on and so forth. But the strategic discussion of the state that was quite distinctive of the 1960s and 70s has disappeared. And indeed, you have very influential Marxists who really say it's a mistake to think about the state. I mean, there's a famous book by John Holloway, a Scottish Marxist who's based in Mexico, very influential in on the autonomist wing of the left, which is called Change the World Without Taking Power. And in essence, he's saying what we should do strategically is ignore the state. The state is a kind of trap. Once we focus on the state, then of necessity, we're caught up in capitalist society, and we reproduce its ways of functioning and thinking, so we need to operate as if the state in essence didn't exist. Now, the neglect of the state is sometimes justified by what is a very fashionable idea in both academic and journalistic circles, namely that the state is irrelevant. That as a result of economic globalization, you know, transnational corporations, financial markets, IT, all that kind of thing, the nation state has lost its power and is being sidelined in the way in which the world is organized. Now, that idea had a very strong influence 15, 20 years ago, and again, the idea was reflected in circles in the left. Most famously, in Michael Hart and Tony Negri's book, Empire, another key text of autonomist Marxism that was very influential in the early stages of the anti-capitalist movement, in the early years of the whatever century we're in. What is it? 21st century. And so, you know, it's one gets muddled, particularly at this stage in Marxism. They say the nation state is finished, and we need to develop strategies which really in which the state doesn't have any place. Now, these kinds of arguments are, I think, quite simply nonsense. The idea that the state or states collectively are marginal to contemporary capitalism it really is nonsense. It doesn't bear serious examination. If we look in a particular at the global economic crisis and how the capitalist classes responded to that crisis, critically, the agency through which that response took place was the state. You know, who? And the most interesting example is the United States. You know, the U.S. is the land of free enterprise. You know, everyone hates big government. Blah 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 blah. The Bush administration was in general very anti-big government, except the bits of big government that involved invading countries and blowing people up. What did the Bush administration do when the financial crisis hit? It's nationalized here, there, and everywhere to save the U.S. financial system. Barack Obama comes along, builds on their policies, and he nationalizes two of the main U.S. car companies, General Motors and Chrysler. So you have the state playing a central role in the capitalist response to the crisis. One reason why the Europeans have made such a total mess out of the crisis in such a spectacular scale is because the European Union isn't a state. It lacks the particular capabilities and resources that states have. So the state is a critical agency in the process of capitalist accumulation and development. It's not obsolete. It's not marginal. So that's the first thing to say. So the kind of excuse for ignoring the state that was fashionable simply doesn't have any bearing on the world in which we find it. It's quite interesting, even when you look at the Tories here, you know, Osborne has made a big deal about how he's a small state liberal, you know, modelling himself on Gladstone in reinventing some weird Gladstonian committee for reducing the national debt and things like that. But actually, you know, Osborne is reducing the size of the state a bit relative to the economy as a whole. Not massively. The state is still, in Britain, as in most of the advanced capitalist countries, the state still takes a very big chunk of overall economic activity, even if the ways in which it does that change over the time. Okay, so the state remains really, really important. There are sections of the radical left in Europe who don't simply ignore the question of the state, and it's very interesting. What they've done is to return to some of the debates of the 1970s. In particular, we find on the left of Syriza in Greece, and to some extent elsewhere in Europe, for example, in Die Linke in Germany, you find a particular interest for the work of the Greek Marxist Nikos Poulantzas, and particularly his last book, State Power Socialism. Now, there was a very good talk about Poulantzas by Dave Sewell last night, and I'm not going to repeat what he dealt with, but I just want to say a bit about Poulantzas, because the reason why Poulantzas has attracted such an interest is, I think, because But particularly for people in some of the new left parties, like Syriza and Die Linke, is because in his last book, Poulenc has put forward a very sophisticated case for a left reformist strategy based upon a particular understanding of the state. And I'm going to use kind of dismantling Poulenc as a way into developing a better understanding of the state. Okay. So what does Poulenc say the state is? Well, he had a real way with words, Poulenc did. He said the state is the specific materialized... The state is a specific materialized condensation of the balance of class forces. As I said, an absolutely pellucid and obvious phrase. The specific materialized condensation of the balance of class forces. What he's saying there is that the state and the kind of configuration of forces within the state, the internal balance of power within the state, reflects the larger balance of class forces in society as large. Why does that license a reformist approach to the state? Because Poulenc has argued that through a combination of pressure from outside the state and struggles inside the state itself, of which the most important would be the election of a left government through the parliamentary process that would preside over the state, you could have a gradual but systematic transformation of capitalist society. So the idea is that the state will shift and change in reflection to the class struggles that take place in the larger society, but also the class struggles that take place within the state itself. Now, there's an important element of truth to this argument. It is true that the way the state operates and the kind of arguments and conflicts that take place in the state is shaped by the larger struggles in society. It is also true that you can have forms of class struggle within the boundaries of the state itself. When we remember that the modern capitalist state is responsible for somewhere between 30 to 50% of national income, in a way that's a necessary truth that there should be class struggle within the boundaries of the state itself, because the state now employs very large numbers of workers, and those workers, you know, teachers, civil servants, etc., form unions, fight for their interests, and can, in all sorts of ways, have an effect on state policy, blocking things, pushing things, and so on and so forth. So that the idea that the state, to some extent, reflects and is shaped by the class struggle is true. There are, I think, two great weaknesses with Poulenc's argument. The first is that although, I mean, this stuff about the particularly weird bit of that definition, a specific materialized condensation, he's gesturing towards the fact that the state has a specific structure, but he doesn't focus sufficiently on that. In other words, when we look at the state, we're talking about a particular set of institutions that are hierarchically organized, that have centralized command structures, and the decision-making processes are ones from which the mass of population are excluded, including the mass of people who work for the state. This is a necessary feature for how the state operates. And this is a critical limitation for anyone who thinks that the state can be somehow made an instrument for social, even socialist change. And there was an interesting illustration of this during the Greek referendum. One of the sort of heroes of the European, indeed the world left, is Yanis Varoufakis, the recently let's be honest, sacked Greek finance minister who heroically defied the Eurogroup and so on. During the referendum week, he tweeted out, "Not in my name," with a picture of a banner on the finance ministry in Athens, which had been created by trade unionists within the finance ministry, saying "Ohi." You know, in other words, a group of civil servants in the finance ministry had organised to make it clear that they were campaigning for a no. And Varoufakis then dissociated himself from that. Why? Because those trade unionists had violated the chain of the command. In the Ministry of Finance, the person who takes political decisions is the Minister of Finance. Everyone else are supposed to be robots who implements the political decisions of the finance ministry. And if you have civil servants getting politicised and taking initiatives, public initiatives, this subverts the whole hierarchical structure of the state. So that little tweet illustrated the extent to which even a left government that is trying to change society can operate in a way that respects and reproducing the existing hierarchies of power in the state. The second limitation with Poulantzas's argument, and it's connected with the first, is that the idea, if the state is simply a kind of incoherent reflection of the class struggles that go in it, both inside it and in the larger society, then the state can, in principle, in a gradual way, be transformed into an instrument of socialist transformation. But there's absolutely no evidence that is going to happen. And indeed, although the state is in all sorts of ways incoherent, suffering from internal conflicts, and so on and so forth, they're quite powerful counter pressures that tend to impose a degree of unity in the state that means that it operates in the interests of capital. One quite interesting example of this is what's been happening recently with the Obama administration. You know, the general tendency recently has been to write Obama off and say it's all completely hopeless, he's done nothing, he's not interested in achieving any real change, and even if he wanted real change, the Republicans in Congress would stop him doing that. In fact, from the point of view of the kind of things that the American ruling class are interested in, he's done quite well recently. He's got the Congress, despite the opposition of his own party, to give him the powers needed to conclude a free trade agreement in the Pacific, which is an important part of American strategy for isolating China, and so on and so forth. In a number of other ways, Obama has been able to achieve the initiative. And this reflects the way in which even in a political system that is as polarized as the American one, between Republicans and Democrats, there are quite powerful pressures to force it to operate in a relatively unified way in the interests of the ruling class. So they're pressures that keep the state coherent and functioning in the interests of capital. Okay, so these are the limitations of the kind of approach that Poulantzas undertakes, I think it's to develop things a bit. We have to ask, okay, what I've been saying is that the state retains a coherence, an effectiveness of functioning that serves in the interests of capital. The question then is, why does it do that? What is it that causes the state ultimately to observe the interests of capital? What is the source of that? And I think the most important answer, and this is an idea that was developed by Chris Harman In a very important article that he wrote called The State and Capitalism Today, that was published, I think, in 1991, but that remains of fundamental relevance. The most important mechanism that binds the state to capital is to do with the global nature of capital and of the capitalist system. As I touched on before, but I need to say more explicitly, there isn't one single state. I mean, one of the confusions in the debate about the state in the 1970s, and this was something that a long-standing comrade of ours, Colin Barker, pointed out at the time, was it talked about the state as if there was one state in the singular, whereas in fact there is a plurality of states. There are many states that compete together but are bound together in the international system of states. But that international system of states is embedded in the global capitalist economy. And what crucially binds together that global capitalist economy is the movement of capital, particularly organized through financial markets. I mean, financial markets are mainly these days a big means through which gambling is organized and short-term profits are made. But through that, the way in which that process of gambling manifests itself is the movement of capital across national borders, famously these days, thanks to IT, very quickly, and so on and so forth. This is a very powerful mechanism for disciplining states, because if a state pursues policies that the financial markets and its, or people say the markets, or the market, it's fascinating the way in which these impersonal networks of competing speculators and thieves and so on get transformed into this singular entity as if it has a will of its own. In any case, if the markets don't like what a particular state is doing, then capital will tend to leave that country. The currency will be bet against in the currency markets. It will fall against other currencies. Through those kinds of mechanisms, the discipline of capital is imposed on particular states. States tend, in order to draw capital back and to prop up their currency, to pursue the policies that will keep the markets happy. And this is the key mechanism that binds states to capital. And it's, in a way, I mean, it's horrible, but it's also quite a beautiful mechanism, because you don't have to, I mean, forget about the market as a single thing. You don't, or single collective will, you don't have to presuppose any kind of conspiracy. It's not that the capitalists plot to force a state to change its policies. Simply through the blind workings of the pursuit of profit on financial markets, capital will shun states that are pursuing policies unattractive to capital. This will force states to change their policies. But there are, of course, twists to this, the way in which this process works. And Greece, as in so many ways, has offered a new twist to the to these methods for disciplining capital, because Greece has been shunned by the financial markets. For years, no one has been willing to lend new money to Greece. So how do you discipline a country that capital has already abandoned? Well, there's a very simple way of doing that. Destroy its banks. Because that's essentially the key mechanism for disciplining Greece and forcing the Syriza government to abandon its policies has been the way in which the European Central Bank hasn't behaved like a central bank. The whole point of central banks is to prop up the rest of the banking system. That's their job. But the European Central Bank reads their rules as if, their rules read, we will prop up private banks except when they're Greek. Or, in reality, except when it's useful to let the banks collapse in order to create such chaos and suffering that you force the government to change policies. So what we're seeing is what we've seen in this case is the way in which the other side innovate. They come up with new weapons for disciplining governments. This is relevant. Of course, this has happened to Greece, but any other country that is part of the Eurozone is subject to the same potential discipline. Don't get out of line, because if you do, the European Central Bank will shut your banks down. And they're very. That's a very important example that we need to reflect upon and need to absorb. Is it inevitable that that kind of policy will be successful? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. It would be possible, you know, if the European Central Bank doesn't shuts down your banks, you can say, okay, well, if you're not going to operate as a proper central bank, we'll re-establish our own central bank. We'll take over the rest of the banking system. We'll nationalise them. And if you're not prepared to give us euros, then we'll start printing our own currency as part of a more general programme of national economic reconstruction. Of course, to do that, you have to have the political will to do it. But there's no technical obstacle to responding to that kind of blackmail. And this is a very important point, that international capitalism puts enormous pressure on recalcitrant governments. That doesn't mean that those recalcitrant governments have to surrender to those pressures. If we were talking about a left government with, if you like, the mass base and the revolutionary will to stand up to those pressures, then they could do so successfully, particularly if they appeal to international support. But of course, it's not just the impersonal mechanism of the financial markets that disciplines governments and keep them in line. There are other unelected centres of power within the state itself. There's, of course, the special bodies of armed men that Engels and Lenin talked about, the army, the police, the intelligence services. There are other agencies that are very important, the courts. Of course, normally unelected, and very often, very conveniently, rolled out in order to defend the existing system. The head of state, sometimes elected, sometimes, as in the case of our own glorious monarch, not elected, also can be a very important centre of legitimacy for the forces of, at the limit, counter-revolution. And again, Greece is a very, not just Greece, but Italy in 2011, when Berlusconi was removed in response to international pressures from the rest of the EU. You see the head of state, normally supposed to be, you know, a neutral, non-political figure, suddenly comes to play a more active role. I'm prepared to bet that in Greece recently, I mean, Tsipras was trying to court a section of the Tory party, so he supported a Tory against his own party, supported a Tory as president. I bet in recent weeks, one of the things that has had Tsipras running scared is what that Tory president might do, you know, potentially sacking the government, creating a government of national unity with the more centre and right-wing parties and so on and so forth. So there are all these unelected centres of power or politically unaccountable centres of power. And we shouldn't forget that central banks, which have become much more important in recent years, are designed to be politically unaccountable as well. These unelected and unaccountable centres of power are mobilised against governments for whom the market discipline isn't enough. And we know what's at the end of this story of different ways in which governments seeking change are disciplined and humbled, and that is, of course, what happened in Chile in September 1973. If a government holds firm, then it can be destroyed by supposedly its own armed forces. One thing that's worth saying is that, and this relates to the debate involving Stathis Kouvelakis earlier today, It's not true. Yeah, that's fine. It's not true that reformists always capitulate, always surrender. Sometimes reformist leaders have the courage and a degree of political will, and they hold firm. This was true of Allende. Allende stood firm against the pressures that were aiming to destroy him and destroy his government. But even when they hold firm, they do in a way that compromises their own position. So that Allende was desperate not to antagonize the conservative forces in Chilean society, not to antagonize the armed forces. So he held back his own supporters who were trying to create different kinds of combat organizations on the ground to resist the coup that they could see coming. And that meant that when the coup took place, Allende was on his own, or with a few aides and so on, effectively on his own in the presidential palace, rather than being defended by an activated and armed working class. Now, that brings me to the point that it is absolutely possible to counter the kind of forces that we're talking about. When we look at the way in which the state is organized and the way in which it works to maintain the existing capitalist system, and even to overcome elected governments to preserve that system, we're trying to understand the enemy and its strength and its resources. That doesn't mean we think the enemy is unbeatable. The enemy can be beaten if there's a sufficiently powerful organization of the working class and mobilization of the working class, which increase, and one in particular, that takes the form of increasingly strong forms of working class self-organization that goes beyond the conventional trade union and political structures, and that begins to unite workers in combat organizations, that begins to unite the whole working class in combat organizations that can not simply resist the other side, but begin to begin to lay the basis for a different kind of state, for a different form of power in society. Because it's very tempting to see two centers of power in society, the power of the state and the power of capital. It's true that both exist. There's a third, and ultimately the power of the state and of capital form one single complex of power. But there's another source of power in society, which is the power of the working class. Again, I know I apologize, this is the umpteenth time I've talked about the Greek referendum, but it's such an important event because we saw a working class asserting itself in a way that drew in its support wider and wider sectors of society. It's that kind of self-mobilization that, if it goes much further, can begin to confront the existing state, to drive it back, and, as I said, to lay the basis of a different kind of state, organized in a much more democratic way than the existing state is. Now, the problem is not that workers don't show their capacity to resist and to reorganize society in the way in which I've described. The problem is, usually, workers don't have the kind of parties that express their ability to do this. They tend to give their support to parties that partially express their aspirations and their demands, but seek to contain those within the framework of existing society. And this helps to be the source of the kind of setback that we've seen in Greece just last night with the parliamentary vote to accept the European Union's terms. But there's nothing inevitable about the dominance of those kinds of parties. The latest form of reformism, the kind of reformism that has emerged with Syriza and Podemos, is being tested in contemporary struggles. And in Greece, it's not emerged very well from that test. That opens the possibility of creating a much stronger revolutionary alternative, not just in Greece, but on the basis of that experience in other countries as well. But creating that alternative means not just organizational strength and social roots, it involves having a theoretical understanding of the state and a strategy for dealing with the state. And that's what we need to discuss much more on the left today than we have been.
You know, yeah, I think we see on a world scale, people have seen with Greece the limits of bourgeois democracy and the bourgeois state for challenging the rich and the powerful. We can see that because the bourgeois state is premised on one thing, the primacy of private property. The amount of wealth that you own, the amount of shares that you own determine your level of power. There. The bourgeoisie have set up a state where they have all the economic levers of power and they can do what they want. That's the way it was set up. And we see the limitations of that. Syriza, they got in office, but they found out they didn't have the power, or they didn't even try to use what little power that they did have. And this has to be a lesson for all of us. Can you imagine if we had 500 SWP MPs and we had a vote in Parliament that we were going to seize Rupert Murdoch's entire empire, and we were unanimous in it? Do you think Rupert Murdoch would say, hands up, I surrender because the vote has gone to take my property? No. He'll say, private property is the most important thing, and they will fight back. And we've seen this time and time again. So I think the big lesson in Greece is the workers who have the power, the workers who are at the point of production. And if Rupert Murdoch's workers around the world occupied and seized his company, he wouldn't have a choice. So the key for us is organizing at the point where we're collectively strong. And the lesson in this country is, if our services are under attack, our people under attack, we want a campaign of civil disobedience, occupations, strikes. We cannot rely on Parliament. And the crisis of social democracy is there for all to see. And I think, because we have a rising mood, a rising anger in this country, that is the only course of action that is really open to people right now. We must seize the time and defeat the Tories and see you on October the 4th at Manchester as we surround the Tory Party conference.
Thank you very much, comrades. I'm glad you're talking about the central bank. I'm from Congo. My government transferred about $350 billion USA to central bank. That's the way they play with our minds. They put their money there, save to central bank. That's our money. It's not their money. I don't know what I'm going to say. Congo is a rich country. We go God damn money, but if you go to Congo, you see the people, they see suffering. But it's a rich country. Why can't the people see suffering over there? We go minerals. Then people, they can't suffer. Why? Central bank. We need to be careful about that. We need to open the eyes about all this scandal they do about the central bank. That's the way they save their money. That's the way the rich people save their money. We need to stand up. Please, comrade, we need to stand up. It's our money. It's on their money. Trust me. It's our money. It's not their money. Without us, they not can be in the power. I sent a letter before the election to David Cameron because I had some issue. He was like, oh, at the moment, my head is all over the place. I can't even look about this way after the election. Then I was cool. I started praying. I said, oh, God, bless this guy to be in the power. Then he be in the power, he started abusing us again. Cutting the benefit for the family. That's not fair. They want our kid to be the criminal one. We need to stand up about that. Thank you very much, comrades.
Um, Another example for bodies of armed men is 40 years since the Portuguese Revolution, 1974-75, and that is an example of the state almost collapsing because under the pressure of the colonial wars in Africa, and the soldiers just had enough of it, and the generals sort of realized and tried to stop the war, and then the soldiers developed their own dynamic with the help of the population, and there were three attempts at a counter-revolution, and the soldiers managed to stop these three attempts. But the problem was that even the best revolutionaries, they didn't manage to gain enough roots within the industrial working class. So in the end, counter-revolution did succeed in the shape of social democracy. So we have the situation we have now. But that is an example of how the state is almost collapsed.
Thank you.
John Molyneux, Irish SWP. I just want to say something about the concept of political neutrality, which I think plays an important role in the way in bourgeois hegemony, in ruling class ideology. Just think about a minute the institutions and areas of society which they claim to be politically neutral. They claim that the monarchy, the Queen, stands above politics and mustn't interfere in politics, politically neutral, represents the nation as a whole. The judges, they're also outside of politics, independent of politics, politically neutral. The armed forces are politically neutral. They represent the nation as a whole. They're not politically biased. The police, they only do their job enforcing the law. They're politically neutral. You get the same thing in the academic world of professors and lecturers and so on who claim to be politically unbiased. They present all sides of the question. They're not biased. They're above politics. And then you get the notion that certain issues ought to be above politics because they're more important than that. What is going on here? They're saying that actually politics is just about Labour versus Tory. Or if you were in Ireland, Fianna Gael versus Fianna Fáil, or the who's represented. It's a narrow little area of society. And all the really fundamental questions are non-political. What this functions to say is that the political debate is just about this or that balance within the system. The system, capitalism, the system as represented by the monarchy, the armed forces, the judges, the police, the courts, everything like that, is not even up for debate. That's outside the realm of politics. You can't even question that. And in that way, it actually disguises the most profound class bias of all these institutions. So I think one of the things that we need to learn from this is the claim that all of political neutrality, whether it's the media, the BBC, the newspapers, or the army or the police or whatever it is always a fiction. These things are profoundly about politics because politics is actually about how society and all our lives are run. And this means that the question of the class nature of the state and the need not only to change the state but to break the class, the bourgeois character of the state and produce a state of our own, to get rid of capitalist politics and replace it with revolutionary and socialist politics, absolutely central question for us in the present time. And whether you look at Egypt or Greece or Ireland or Britain or anywhere else, this question is coming more and more to the fore. I think it's absolutely central, and it means that Lenin's old book, State and Revolution, is the central text for revolutionary politics in our time.
I think one of the ways in which you can see the state being used on behalf of capital, I think, was evident in the recent budget announcement, actually, because you can clearly see the way in which the ruling class know that the attacks that they're going to have to launch are going to meet with resistance, and therefore they have to make it as difficult as possible for us to resist. And you look at the legislation around the ballot requirements for strikes and so on. These are clearly designed to make sure that it's going to be easier for capital to try and restore its profitability by basically screwing us harder and making it harder for us to fight back. And I think that one of the things that's really important is that we don't, you know, when we talk about fighting, it's not just talking about fight, 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 but it's also not just talking about, oh, wait for the revolutionary crisis and then we'll start talking about the state. We have to do the two things together now. So we have to start talking now within the struggles, and while we're talking about how we're going to fight back, we have to start talking and raising these arguments about the state. You can't just, you know, we've got to wait until we get into, a crisis situation. As Alex said, even in Greece now, for the majority of workers still clinging to that idea, that reformist idea, that somehow you can use the state. We have to build those arguments now. So really, it's one of the reasons why we have to be political in terms of the way that we operate inside our unions and wherever we are inside our campaigns. The question of the state isn't something that can wait for the revolution. The question of the state is something that we have to raise within every struggle that we're doing now.
I would like to first thank Alex for his talk, and I totally agree with it, and on the aspect of this class characteristic of the state. I think even though we have to go even deeper in this perspective, and I wanted to ask you if you could maybe expand on the issue about, you know, the security apparatus and ideological apparatus of the state on Althusser's basis, and as well, coming back to the, as well, Lenin talked about the state in revolution, but I think Gramsci's question about force and consent, and especially when you talk about, in your last article on Greece, about the Greek working class winning a hegemony. And I think this is a key issue, because wherever you go in the civil society, we shouldn't understand it only as a, you know, the ideological apparatus of the state in a public way. But when we see the medias in Greece, we're completely controlled by the private media. And wherever you go in Europe, you check out the television, the medias, even though you had maybe 66% of the Greek people, because with the 5% abstention of the KKE, voting against the memorandum, whoever you saw on television, whether Swiss, British, French, was people for the yes. And amazing. And these are neutral media, as presented by it. So this aspect about the winning hegemony is a key, I think, issue today. When we talk about the state, about and bringing back, I think, to some extent, Gramsci ideas about winning a kind of hegemony among the working class, and also to bring back the aspect that the only way to win this hegemony is the self-emancipation of the working class. And this we saw in Greece during the week before the referendum, comrades working like hell for the no. So I think we can expand also on this issue. I would like you please to expand on it.
I think one of the reasons that you really need to have an understanding of the theory of what the state is when you read something like Naomi Klein's excellent book, This Changes Everything, on climate change, you can see that she doesn't actually seem to have a full understanding of the state. She talks about, the problem of climate change, if one is unregulated, unbridled capitalism, but she doesn't actually seem to place the role of the state anywhere in that. She talks about the state's abandonment, for instance, of places like the suburbs of the poor suburbs of New York, in New Orleans after the Hurricane Sandy and after the Hurricane Katrina, but she doesn't talk about the role of the state. And without an understanding of the state and its role, she doesn't have a solution to how you can actually challenge the system. And she doesn't actually talk about why you need to challenge the law. I mean, as a trade unionist, we're always told to operate within the law, and that's the problem. If you're going to be a reformist, then you can't challenge the state, because at one day you want to be elected and take over it. So how can you then do illegal things if you're then going to be in charge of the state? As a postal worker, our biggest win ever was in 2003, when we had an illegal unofficial strike that spread across a quarter of the postal workers in this country. And whenever we operated within the system, we may have had some gains, but never as much as the gains we had when we went out illegally and unofficial and challenged the system itself. So that's why when you're fighting for reforms, you also have to ask the question of the nature of the state and what strategy and tactics you should be using. And one thing I was looking forward to is that, if Greece had actually rejected the austerity, the Parliament had actually rejected the austerity budget, the austerity terms being imposed by the EU, it brings into question the whole role of the state in defending property relations, in the whole role of money in the system. I mean, in practice, there isn't any money in the banks. It's an all accounting mechanism. There are people doing work, and it's a question of how they're rewarded for doing that work, whether they get money that they can buy goods and services with. Is there another way of doing these things? I mean, we're also seeing alternative currencies being set up in some communities across parts of Europe and across parts of the world. But actually, what a Greek exit would have done would have been a great opportunity to bring to question the whole idea of the state as a defender of private property and the allocation of resources within society. And that hasn't happened yet, but it's up to the working class in Greece and us here to make that a real question.
I was very disappointed when I heard that the Greek government had accepted the offer from the EU. I can't imagine any other situation in the near future, if ever, when a government is going to get such a resounding backing from a working class who had been so attacked and demined for so many years, and yet still it had the courage, it had the balls to say no. But unfortunately, for me, I mean, and perhaps I don't know as much as I should know about it, but to me, I just think that the government didn't have the balls. And perhaps I've misunderstood, Alex, but for what you said, did you say that once the backing is there and Greece had that backing, then all you need is the political will? And the Greek government just didn't have the political will. And if I was a Greek person now, I'd feel utterly betrayed. And personally, the question I'd like to ask, Alex, is had they said no, I think they underestimated their own power. I think had they said no, they would have been more respected and the EU would have given them more. But I'd like to hear your comments on what you think the reaction would have been, and also how they could have managed. I mean, how does a country manage when it puts a finger up to capitalism? Can it exist? That's the fundamental question. And I would like to think it could.
Yes, I wanted to come back on this question about hegemony and Greece, because I think the first thing you can say is that when you're talking about the kind of struggle, the level of struggle against the European agglomeration of states, if not a single state, and indeed the European Central Bank as the main disciplining centre of that imperial conglomeration. We can argue about whether it's or not it's a state, but essentially the crucial question really is, what social force has the ability to smash that state and to smash the Greek state and any ability of the international ruling class to discipline a Greek working class? And secondly, what kind of organisation is necessary to force through an alternative economic strategy, an alternative vision for Greece? Because it's not. I think it seems to me that if you look at the Greek crisis, on the one hand, it's not enough. I don't think it's enough to just talk about a crisis of hegemony, because there's a sort of tendency on the left, and particularly on the Euro-communist left, to talk about Gramsci as though it's some kind of trick that you can call, as Tsipras did, some kind of referendum in order to shore up a political position and then completely do a U-turn and go into negotiations. This kind of idea that you can, that the working class is a stage army of history. We get this in our own trade union movement. You know when a trade union bureaucracy is about to sell you out because they ask you what you think. I mean, it's the first rule of trade union sellouts is to put something unpalatable to a vote, but with no plan B. And the problem in Greece is that Syriza offered no plan B. What would Grexit look like? This was never articulated. And the problem is that for the movement, is then that becomes the political question, because there's a vacuum that is opened up. And so the question about state and revolution is always a concrete question. It's always about what kind of alternative method of organizing society is on offer if you are pushed to the pushed into a situation of being pushed out of the existing status quo. In Greece, you know, what are the social forces that could provide that? Well, firstly, there have been general strikes. Secondly, there have been occupations of factories. But probably the most important form of organisation are the workers' councils that have begun to be set up in Athens and elsewhere, and the organisation in the squares, because those are the kinds of organisations that, like Soviets in Russia in 1917, represent the beginnings of dual power. They represent an alternative way of feeding and clothing people and organising society in a different way with a different kind of state. Because Lenin didn't simply argue what we have to do is smash a capitalist state to create a new capitalist state. He said, no, we have to smash the capitalist state to provide the space to allow a worker state to run society in its place.
Thank you. Yeah, I've got a question, actually. Well, it's not really a question. I know what you're going to say, Alex, but a request for comment, really. I want to talk about a particular element of the state. And the reason for this, it's become quite current, actually, with a campaign Russell Brand started running, the Love the Police campaign. I don't know if people heard about that recently. I was at an EDL demo not too long ago, and I was trying to get everyone organised, and this guy was really getting on my nerves because he just spent the whole demo speaking to the police. And there was like a line of fascists that we had to deal with. And I said to him, what are you doing? Why are you speaking to the police? He said, I had an idea. And I was like, oh, really? What's your idea? He said, well, basically, the Tories are going to be making some cuts on the police soon. So if we maybe, you know, get friends with them, they'll be on our side. And I was, now, there is this pernicious argument that I keep hearing, actually, on some sections of the left, that the police are just workers in badges. And I just wanted to see if you could comment on that, really. Thanks.
From Austria, the Austrian Social Democratic Party in the 20s was a very powerful organization, very powerful party. In the so-called Austrian Revolution from November 1918 to August 1919, they got almost every reform they wanted from, as they were in a coalition party with the conservatives, because the ruling class was in a complete mess and was so defensive, they would give them everything just to prevent revolution. The leader of their party, Otto Bauer, said that there was no power in Austria which could stop the soldiers and workers' councils from taking power and having a Soviet state. As soon as the ruling class regained their self-consciousness, they started attacking with, you know, a fascist group. They started attacking with the army, and they rebuilt a police force. There wasn't a police force at the very beginning. It was only workers and soldiers who held order in the country. And looking back at this experience from Austria and from Germany, a phrase was coined, which is, I think, also significant today. They thought they had the power, but they only were in government.
Alex stressed the importance of the plurality of states and how this becomes a financial markets become a mechanism to impose the logic of capital in its separate state. The other part of it is old-fashioned military competition. Just 2 days before the betrayal in the parliament yesterday, in the Greek parliament, the Greek foreign minister met the Israeli leadership. And this has been a tactic pursued by the Syriza government since it came into power. The logic says that the power of the Greek state is an asset that we can use in order to gain even in the negotiation table. We have to have an alliance with Israel and with the dictatorship of Egypt in order to go on being the stability, the stabilization force, so that we can have allies were, for example, the United States, even on the negotiation tables. The cunning version of that argument was we have to bring Russia into the table to show that we can change the alliance to that side. Actually, we can imagine what's the result of all this. It's not only it doesn't bring a result in the negotiation table, on the other side it gives more power to the army, to the armaments industry, and so on and so forth. It's obvious to ask ourselves what Tsipras had a photo opportunity with Sisi, the dictator of Egypt. What is in the interest of the Greek working class? For Sisi to stabilize Egypt in the way he does, or for the Egyptian workers to overthrow Sisi? That's an easy answer for us, but for the reformists that don't have a clear answer or a strategy about the state, it's not clear. Actually, and the last point is this, that the left part of Syriza, this was the argument that was the weakest part, because they have been having arguments against the strategy on Euro and the European Union and so on and so forth. But on this specific point, what's the importance of Greece as a stabilization force in the Mediterranean and the Balkans? They followed the same route.
I was the Tusk candidate for Tottenham in the election campaign, and at the end of the election, one of the local college governors said to me, bit patronisingly, "You ran a really good campaign, what are you going to do now? Why don't you go into politics?" Because I think the idea that we're fed is that politics, adult, responsible politics, is about managing the system within the framework that we're given. And I think really this is the clue as to why Labour lost the election and why we're in the state we're in. Because what we've seen is right across the country, the cities controlled by Labour, it's been Labour councils managing the system within the framework they've been given. So they're the ones who've been pushing through austerity. They're the ones that have been sacking workers. They're the ones that have been closing facilities for the elderly and for disabled people, because they're accepting the framework that we're given. Because the alternative, actually, is you have to engage the workers. You have to take a class position to struggle. Because if Labour had a strategy for resistance, they could have actually stopped the cities right across the country. But that would have involved getting the council workers out on strike. It would involve occupying council housing instead of selling it off. It would have involved a class struggle. And I think this is the situation that we're faced with into the future. We know that austerity is going to be ramped up. And what we've got to start doing now is engaging young people in politics, but saying that politics isn't about getting elected into positions of influence. Politics from the ground up is about getting engaged in occupations, in strike actions, in actually class politics that are going to stop the wheels turning. Because that is the only way that we can actually have any kind of conception about what power we've got and how we're going to take power for ourselves.
Hello, my name is Małgorzata. I represent the Movement for Social Justice from Poland. I want to comment on those questions, how to avoid the military coup in Greece, how to fight against the central bank, and how to make the working class stronger. And I think we have to think about working on the international level, because it is easy to cut one strike in one country, but it's very difficult to cut a general strike in more than one country, in one or two or three or even five countries. You always have to, you know, run for the solidarity demos and solidarity strikes in different countries. Because if you work on international level, you represent international force, and it's very difficult, you know, for one country to operate in different countries. And this is an international organization. This is an international movement. So we have to just use this force. And that's pretty simple. Thank you.
Yeah, both Alex and John Molyneux made the very big claim that Lenin's pamphlet State and Revolution, written in 1917, is in fact one of the key texts for the 21st century. Now, that's a big claim, but I think this afternoon, in the debate between Alex and Stathis Kouvelakis, we saw how justified that claim is. You see, because as I listened to that debate this afternoon, I had a huge sense of frustration
and irritation that Stathis said the game was over. Now, what's the explanation for that? Why does he take that view? The man wants to change the world. He wants to stand by Greek workers, students, pensioners, and so on. And there is one explanation which says he is really washing his hands and he is a conventional politician. I don't believe that is the explanation. The explanation is that he hasn't taken on board the lesson of state and revolution. What he does is to adopt Polanski's view of the state. Now, this is not an abstract argument, comrades, because we as an organisation, in the tradition of revolutionary socialism, know there is an alternative to the convention reformist road. And that is the tradition of the Paris Commune. It's the tradition of the Soviets of 1905. It's the tradition of the Soviets in 1917, the Hungarian Soviets, and so on and so forth. In other words, to grasp the essentials of the state and revolution, which is not only can the bourgeois state be smashed, but we have a concept, we have an idea of what a new society, not only that we aspire to, but how it can be organized, that's the essence of the state and revolution. And why, therefore, what we'd have to do, it seems to me, is to reintroduce, as Alex has suggested, the essence of revolutionary socialism as we work in terms of trying to take advantage of the new mood that we believe is beginning to emerge in Britain today.
Joshua Brown from the Glasgow Soviet. In Scotland, we've had quite an interesting modernized exposure to Lenin's pamphlet called An Independence Referendum. A lot of people thought that was about Scottish nationalism or it was about some historic oppression, or there are all kinds of explanations for what that meant. But in actuality, what it meant is people had to start to think about what kind of society did they want to live in, begin to envision what it would be like to have a bit more say in your own destiny, which opens up a huge number of possibilities and some fantastic political discussions. But what it also does is it challenges the British state. And some people would try and use fear-mongering and say, oh, are you calling for the breakup of the British state or the British Empire? And the members of the Socialist Workers' Party would say, yes, you're damn right we are. Absolutely. That's where there's massive potential involved in it. But then members of the Communist Party and the Labour Party would say to us, oh, but aren't you internationalists? Don't you believe in workers' solidarity? And we said, absolutely, we're internationalists. If there's a border there, we see past it. We stood in solidarity and raised £2,000 for the Americana miners to stay out until they won their strike to feed their families so that they could defy the bosses and win in the platinum mines in South Africa. There are a lot of borders between Scotland and South Africa, but we don't see them. We stand in solidarity with workers in struggle. So if there was some sort of theoretical border at Hadrian's Wall, it wasn't going to stop us from supporting the strikers at the National Gallery fighting against privatization and austerity. So how would that change things? It would give us an opportunity to have a more democratic say in our own future. And at first, the British government didn't really take us seriously. They thought, oh, there's no way they're ever going to win. In fact, the Tories set up the Edinburgh Agreement with a single question, aye or no. In fact, they said yes or no. Because they didn't want Devo Max. They thought if they kept that off the ballot paper, then the SNP was going to lose the referendum and it would destroy the SNP for generations. They wouldn't have to worry about it anymore. But what they didn't realize is that people in Scotland were sick and tired to the back teeth of austerity, of wars, of cuts, of closures, of privatization. And that's what the campaign became about. Even Alex Salmond learned that between the first and second debates and televised debates. In the first one, he totally lost because he tried to play to the Labour line about currency and all this rubbish. But when he started talking about defending the NHS, getting rid of Trident nuclear weapons, spending the money on schools and education and so forth, he was wiping the floor with Alistair Darling, and we went into the lead. The Yes campaign went into the lead. At that point, the British state panicked, and they threw everything they had at trying to scare people, intimidate people, bribe people, lie to people, whatever they had to do in order to stop it. Because at the end of the day, the viability of the British state was on the line, and they finally woke up to the fact that they could lose it. So, unfortunately, we didn't quite make the threshold. But what we did do is we let the genie out of the bottle. Scotland is still experiencing a historic level of political engagement. The genie is out of the bottle. People want to have a say in their own destiny. And we're channeling that into campaigns against nuclear weapons, campaigns to shut Dungavel Detention Center, stop racism, fight fascism, get an end to privatization, protect the NHS, all these sort of things against austerity. The SNP has been shaped by that, at least their rhetoric. We have to expose their actual deeds and build a political formation to the left of them that we can actually begin to take hold of our own destiny, even though we weren't quite able to break up the British state. The next time round, we definitely will, I think.
Just after Richard, is there a man over here who wanted to have his hand up? He disappeared. Well, in that case, you afterwards, you'll be the last speaker.
Yeah. Comrades, yeah, I want a little bit of a tangent, really, which I think we have to actually take on the reformist argument of capturing the state is how we bring reforms. Because actually, if you think about it, to me, the majority of Green people I talk to, the Green Party supporters, accept the argument that capitalism is destroying the environment, the two are incompatible. What they think is we'll get a Green government and that'll stop it. Right? And I think the argument is going to come out with Jeremy Corbyn and so on and so forth. It's an argument we may think is over and done with. It's not. And I think we need to repeat it. When we had the start of the cuts, we had a big meeting in Coventry, and the Comrades and Socialist Party, Dave Nelly, stood up and said the answer to fighting the cuts is to elect anti-cuts councillors. Right? We had a packed meeting. The answer was not for you to do anything. It was to elect me and other people in the council, in the part of the state, to oppose it. Right? That was the argument that was put. And I think we need to take on the argument. Reforms do not come about because of particular individuals, in particular, whoever's in Parliament. Reforms come about for three things, I think. The needs of capitalism, the balance of class forces, and the combination of both. Right? And if you look at the history of Britain and reforms, how they've come about, pre-First World War, it's the unrest that pushes the Liberal government into creating reforms. Actually, 1918-19 government, which was described by Winston Churchill as a load of businessmen who'd made profits out of the war, that was his description of them, repealed none of those reforms because of the movement from below. Right? The 1945 Labour government, again, actually, we all know it, Quinton Hogg said, if we don't give the workers social reform, they'll give us social revolution. Right? Reforms have been created, whether it be a Conservative government or a Labour government, and they've been attacked, whether it be a Labour government or a Conservative government, depending upon the balance of class forces that we've had at our disposal. And I think it's an important argument we take, because although we think no one has any illusions, actually, people coming to me at work saying, actually, Richard, should we join the Labour Party because Jeremy Corbyn is standing, and I can't believe I'm the only comrade who's had people outside the party coming to them and saying, should we join, Richard? What do you think? Should we do that? Is it worth it? I don't agree with the Labour Party, but I'll lie. I'll just pay £3 and lie to get Jeremy Corbyn. You know what I mean? Actually, that's an illusion that partly it's just to put two fingers up to Blairism and the Tories, but also it'll make a difference. You know, capturing the state will make a difference. And we have to take that argument on. It's a difficult argument, but actually we have to go through it and historically go through the history of reforms in Britain, where they come from and where they were lost. And we should always remember the first monetarist government in Britain, the first neoliberal government in Britain, was the Labour government. Right? It was James Callaghan, Harold Wilson and the social contract. It wasn't Margaret Thatcher. She followed on from that. And that we need to run the argument through.
Right, you'll have to be short because there's somebody else as well. So okay, if you both take a couple of minutes.
I will be short. I want to come back short on Nikos Poulantzas, because this whole idea of seizing the state kind of from the outside and the inside is nothing new. The comrade before talked of Otto Bauer and Austro-Marxism. There were two problems with that I want to point out. The first thing, there will come a moment when such a government has to hold back the movement from outside, outside the parliament. Actually, when the workers' councils in Hungary were short of arms, and they called to send them arms, the Austrian government and Otto Bauer refused to send the arms. Although the councils and the workers wanted to send them, but they hold them back, and that crushed the revolution in Hungary. The other problem with this strategy of seizing the state from inside and outside is what Otto Bauer actually did. He incorporated the councils, a kind of in the dual power. The workers' council incorporated into the state. He cleaned these councils from the political from kind of political institutions and reduced them to legal institutions and incorporated into the bourgeois state. So that's just two points. What the problems with the strategies?
Right. I think I'm shorter, but perhaps not so brief. There is a formal vision of the state, and there is a real state, and I think we have to make a real distinction. We have a fairy tale state and the one that's really existent. I'll give some examples to make the point. In 1905, I guess, when Kaiser Wilhelm visited Morocco to talk about Lebensraum, he did not only do diplomacy, he also installed spies. During the Second World War, these spies produced propaganda to play out Jews and Arabs in order to fit with German imperialist interests. In all countries during the Second World War, there were stay-behind networks absolutely loyal to their bourgeoisie. They were armed and prepared to fight for it. In the Russian Revolution, there were, after the revolution, disparate examples of counter-revolutionary activity. And I think they have in common, we are talking about one thing that's never formally mentioned by the bourgeoisie or their ideologies. It's the deep state. The police is a problem, the army is a problem, but the deep state, after we would have won everything, is a problem as well. Because after that, they will stoke, they will try to destabilize the revolution, just as we see in Greece today, just as we see in Egypt today, and just as we see in the Netherlands today, because nowadays in the Netherlands, anti-racist activists are disappearing and we don't know where they are. It's the Obama method, Guantanamo Bay, what have you. The deep state is doing this sort of thing. So when we think we're ready and we're starting our own democracy, we should not be naive, expect this sort of thing, because they will be trying to make our world into a mess, and we should be prepared for that and think of methods to fight them.
Okay, so Alex will now sum up.
Thanks. I want to start with the question of political neutrality that John Molyneux spoke about, and it relates to the comrade from Congo was saying when he was complaining about central banks. I don't know if you're from the DRC, which is a country that has suffered most terribly at the hand of global capitalism and the various... Sorry? That's the one. Yeah, good. I mean, one of the things that I always think about when the IMF gets up and says we have to be virtuous and so on is that in the 1990s, documents appeared that were produced from the IMF that said they knew that the money that they were lending the then dictator of what's now the DRC, Mobutu, the ruler of what was then called Zaire, was stealing it, using it for his family, special accounts in Switzerland and all that kind of thing. But they weren't going to do anything about it because he was on the right side in the Cold War. That's the essence of international capitalism. They pick their sides in terms of who they're going to back, and their friends get everything, their enemies they seek to destroy. But I think it's also important to say that we find ourselves talking about central banks a lot these days. And there's a specific reason for that, which is that part of neoliberalism involves not getting rid of the state, but restructuring it and transferring as much economic power as possible to central banks. And these days, the central banks are supposed to be neutral, going back to what John said about the ideology of neutrality. They're run by experts. They're not supposed to be politically accountable. They have nothing to do with elected politicians and so on. The reality is completely different. you see this, Mario Draghi, the president of the European Central Bank, you know, neutral expert, when it comes to crushing Greece, he steps forward to do his part of the job in shutting down the Greek banking system and trying to asphyxiate Greek society in the way in which we've seen in the past few weeks. So central banks, even when they don't play the kind of very brutal role of the European Central Bank, are tremendously important. If we look at Britain or the United States, the central bank increasingly is the key part of the state in managing the economy, and they play a very important role, pouring money, again, in this case, not asphyxiating banks, but pouring money into the banking system through policies of quantitative easing. So this is a particularly important form in which the enemy takes that is hard to address because banking itself and money and so on are subjects that are presented in ways that it seems impossible for ordinary people to understand. But it's a way in which the enemy has redeployed in recent times. On the question of hegemony that that Joseph Daho raised, I mean, Gramsci understood hegemony as a synthesis of force and consent. In other words, a ruling class exerts its domination of society not through simply having physical coercive power, the army, the police, etc., but through its ideological dominance and, in particular, as Gramsci put it, its ability to represent its interests as the interests of society as a whole. Now, because the ruling class, even in the so-called rich countries, is able to offer ordinary people less and less in the way of economically, we find other ways in which it tries to shore up its hegemony. One is the very theme of security, the war on terror, protecting ourselves from the Islamist threat, the way in which ISIS has been hyped up as a kind of existential threat to all of us. That is designed to push us around the state, and it has, of course, the very convenient effect from the point of view of the state itself, not simply to help shore up consent, but to justify giving more power to the security apparatuses of the state, the police, the army, all these new powers that Cameron has been claiming since the atrocity in Tunisia recently. So these are some of the ways in which hegemony works at the present time. I don't agree at all with Sean Wallace that we should simply look on the concept of hegemony with suspicion because it was misused by Euro-communists. It's a very important concept for us. We would like to be in a position to be able to fight for hegemony in British society, to present not ourselves as the SWP in our present form, but to be part of a revolutionary workers' movement that could present itself as a solution to the problems of society. And one of the things that Gramsci emphasised, that if you approach things in a hegemonic way, you don't just look at economic questions. So the question of Scotland and our willingness to support a campaign that would have broken up the British imperialist state is an example of the kind of hegemonic politics that you have to take up if you're a serious revolutionary Marxist organisation. The question of the European Union is not one that we can afford to leave to the Europhobes and to the idiot defenders of the EU. The ruling class aren't idiots, but people like Juncker, the people who nominally run the EU. We have to have a concrete stand on the European Union in present circumstances. One comrade asked, did Syriza underestimate its own power? Yes. Was the problem simply a lack of political will? I think political will is very important. Importance, but political will isn't just a matter of, you know, being like Nietzsche, you know, I'm really strong, I'm going to assert my will and show how tough I am and so on. Will, there's a connection between will and how you imagine the possibilities. The problem with the leaders of Syriza is they didn't conceive of a possibility of a good outcome that would involve breaking with the European Union. They could only imagine a good outcome that involved remaining within the European Union. And that gave enormous power to the other side that we see exercised now. But will isn't enough. You have to have organisation. And you have to have an organisation that taps the immense power of ordinary working people. So, you know, Syriza that was fighting for the transformation of Greek society would have had a meeting of its MPs, you know, in the last couple of days. And what that meeting would have said, OK, right, we're rejecting the deal, and that means we're going to have to push an alternative that may mean breaking with the European Union. The government will stay in Athens to begin to organise that. Every MP, go to your constituency and help and do everything that you can to explain what we're doing and to promote the organisation of the kind of support that we're going to need to carry through that programme. That would have been a real radical left party that saw its central leadership bodies, like its ministers and MPs and so on, as part of a much larger network that it helped to activate, you know, in order to mobilise for an alternative to what's happening. And that would have involved technical stuff, taking control of the banks, beginning to print an alternative currency. This isn't, you know, bizarre. I mean, I'd forgotten, but in 2008, the height of the financial crisis, California ran out of money. They started printing coupons, IOUs that they started paying their bills in and so on. The world didn't come to an end. Now, on its own, that wouldn't transform things, but their technical things to do with the financial system that they could have done as part of a much broader programme for beginning to transform Greek society. Greek bosses were saying, we're going to have to lay off our workers because we've run out of money. Take over any company that lays off workers, take it over. The government takes it over under workers' control. That you could see through that kind of programme of resistance an alternative opening up. Okay, so what else have I got to say? I better shut up. So political will isn't enough on its own, but political will linked to an informed understanding of the realities of society and the alternatives open, and linked to an understanding of the working class as an agent of change, that could change anything. Final point of all, comrade from Holland talked about, the first comrade from Holland who spoke, talked about the importance of international solidarity. Absolutely right. We see the Russian Revolution as our great example, but we know the Russian Revolution was eventually defeated because the revolution didn't spread. The story isn't over in Greece, and if the Greek masses come back and hit back and begin to drive things in the right direction, then they are going to need an enormous amount of solidarity from workers and socialists and anti-capitalists and anti-austerity activists in the rest of Europe to stop all the countermeasures that the EU will mount against them. So international solidarity is crucial for any serious revolutionary project.